Welcome. Grace and peace be with you. I'm Paul Stevens, the ordained minister in placement at St Luke's Uniting Church in Highton. And welcome to this online service to mark Maundy Thursday and Good Friday. Worship on Easter Sunday at St Luke's will be in person in the church building at 9:30 a.m. And you're warmly invited to join us, especially if you've been perhaps only watching us online. Why not take the opportunity to join with us in person? On this occasion on which we celebrate the resurrection of Jesus. But to speak now of the resurrection is to get a little ahead of ourselves. Right now in this video, our focus is on the dark events which ended with Jesus dying in a most terrible way and the meaning of those events for us today, 2,000 years later. Have you ever stopped to ponder what Jesus and his arrest and his crucifixion mean for you? How does the cross of Christ impact on you and your life today? Let's now pause in prayer, seeking God's leading and guidance as we journey back 2,000 years to Jerusalem and ponder the things that happened there. Let's pray. God of light, God who is present even in the valley of the dark shadow, open our ears and hearts as we travel with Jesus to Calvary. Help us to recognize that what happened so long ago impacts on us, that what Jesus did was for us and for all. Help us to see meaning in these dark events. And this we pray in the name of Jesus Christ. Amen. We'll now hear a series of readings from the Gospel writer Mark's account of the events leading up to and including the death of Jesus. We'll also hear some reflections from individuals on the significance of the cross for them. Jesus had entered Jerusalem on a colt with crowds praising him and declaring, "Hosanna, blessed is the one who comes in the name of the Lord." After resting in Bethany, he had returned to Jerusalem and gone into the temple and caused a stir by tossing out the traders and money changers. He then spent time in and around the city, teaching his disciples and others who would listen, as well as disputing with religious leaders. But dark forces conspired against him, and one of his own followers, for reasons that remain unclear, went to the chief priests and agreed to betray Jesus for money. On Thursday evening, Jesus shared the Passover with his disciples and as part of the meal broke bread saying, "This is my body," and shared a cup of wine saying, "This is my blood of the covenant which is poured out for many." Jesus and the disciples then went out to Gethsemane to pray. And while his disciples slept, Jesus struggled deeply in prayer with his Father about what was to come.
Immediately, while he was still speaking, Judas, one of the 12, arrived. And with him there was a crowd with swords and clubs, from the chief priests, the scribes, and the elders. Now the betrayer had given them a sign, saying, "The one I will kiss is the man. Arrest him and lead him away under guard." So when he came, he went up to him at once and said, "Rabbi," and kissed him. Then they laid hands on him and arrested him.
They took Jesus to the high priest, and all the chief priests, the elders, and the scribes were assembled.
The high priest asked Jesus, "Are you the Messiah, the Son of the Blessed One?" Jesus said, "I am, and you will see the Son of Man seated at the right hand of the power, and coming with the clouds of heaven." Then the high priest tore his clothes and said, "Why do we still need witnesses? You have heard his blasphemy. What is your decision?" All of them condemned him as deserving death.
My parents gave me this cross when I was 14 years old for my confirmation. I wear it every day as a reminder that Jesus walks beside me.
While Peter was below in the courtyard, one of the servant girls of the high priest came by. When she saw Peter warming himself, she stared at him and said, "You also were with Jesus, the man from Nazareth." But he denied it, saying, "I do not know or understand what you are talking about." And he went out into the forecourt. Then the cock crowed, and the servant girl, on seeing him, began again to say to the bystanders, "This man is one of them," but again he denied it. Then after a little while, the bystanders again said to Peter, "Certainly you are one of them, for you are a Galilean." But he began to curse and he swore an oath, "I did not know this man you are talking about." At that moment, the cock crowed for the second time. Then Peter remembered that Jesus had said to him, "Before the cock crows twice, you will deny me three times." And he broke down.
For me, the cross is one of the most brutal ways to hurt people in history, and it's just so amazing that Jesus was willing to stay there, because he didn't need to, but he was willing to stay there so that my sins would be forgiven. And it always reminds me that I should never take that lightly, that sin is such a nasty thing that we've got to deal with it.
As soon as it was morning, the chief priests held a consultation with the elders and scribes and the whole council. They bound Jesus, led him away, and handed him over to Pilate. Pilate asked him, "Are you the King of the Jews?" He answered him, "You say so." Then the chief priests accused him of many things. Pilate asked him again, "Have you no answer? See how many charges they bring against you." But Jesus made no further reply, so that Pilate was amazed. Now at the festival, he used to release a prisoner for them, anyone for whom they asked. Now a man called Barabbas was in prison with the rebels who had committed murder during the insurrection. So the crowd came and began to ask Pilate to do for them according to his custom. Then he answered them, "Do you want me to release for you the King of the Jews?" For he realized that it was out of jealousy that the chief priests had handed him over. But the chief priests stirred up the crowd to have him release Barabbas for them instead. Pilate spoke to them again, Then what do you wish me to do with the man you call the King of the Jews? They shouted back, crucify him! Pilate asked them, why? What evil has he done? But they shouted all the more, crucify him! So Pilate, wishing to satisfy the crowd, released Barabbas for them, and after flogging Jesus, he handed him over to be crucified.
The cross means everything to me. It's the most powerful thing in the world, and without it, we would all be in darkness. But because of it, we can have hope, we can have life, we can have peace, we can have freedom. Then the soldiers led him into the courtyard of the palace, that is the governor's headquarters, and they called together the whole cohort. And they clothed him in a purple cloak, and after twisting some thorns into a crown, they put it on him. And they began saluting him, Hail, King of the Jews! They struck his head with a reed, spat upon him, and knelt down in homage to him.
After mocking him, they stripped him of the purple cloak and put his own clothes on him. Then they led him out to crucify him. They compelled a passerby who was coming in from the country to carry his cross. It was Simon of Cyrene, the father of Alexander and Rufus. Then they brought Jesus to the place called Golgotha, which means the place of the skull. And they offered him wine mixed with myrrh. They crucified him and divided his clothes among them, casting lots to decide what each should take.
When it was noon, darkness came over the whole land until 3 p.m. At 3 o'clock, Jesus cried out with a loud voice, Eloi, Eloi, lama sabachthani, which means, my God, why have you forsaken me? When some of the bystanders heard it, they said, Listen, he's calling for Elijah. And someone ran filled with a sponge with sour wine, put it on a stick and gave it to him to drink, saying, Wait, let us see whether Elijah will come to take him down. Then Jesus gave a wild cry and breathed his last. And the curtain of the temple was torn in two from top to bottom. Now when the centurion, stood facing him, saw that in this way he breathed his last, he said, Truly this man was God's son.
Oh, Jesus died for all people on the cross. So that's what it means to me, that he died for me. And the beautiful part of the story is that wasn't the end. That was only the beginning when he rose from the dead on the third day.
The cross is known across the globe as the sign of the Christian faith. Churches are bedecked with crosses, Christians wear crosses, and many members of some Christian traditions make the sign of the cross as a sign of prayer. But the cross is a very strange symbol for an organisation when you begin to think about it. The Romans used crosses to execute people in an intentionally slow, painful, and gruesome way. Crucifixion was a form of execution designed to humiliate and shame the person being killed. It was kept as a form of death for those who the Romans desired to make a spectacle of, for runaway slaves, for traitors. Look around the world and you will see that countries and organisations like to use symbols which speak of victory, of strength, dominance, control, competence and worldly power. Countries like Russia, the USA and Germany, for example, have coats of arms that include eagles to emphasise the strength of their nation. The Roman Empire used an eagle as its standard. And the British Empire, of course, was all about the lion. There's even one country that has an AK-47 rifle on its flag. These are symbols far different from the one that we are thinking about today, the cross, which speaks of humiliation and death. So why the cross as a symbol for the church? Well, the cross is where we look to find the true nature of the divine. As the centurion, the one overseeing the crucifixions, said of Jesus after he had died, "Truly this man was God's son." On the cross, of all places, the divine breaks in. In John's Gospel, the cross is emphasized as the place where Jesus is lifted up and glorified. Lifted up and glorified because on the cross, Jesus suffers with us and for us. On the cross, Jesus shares in the suffering of all who suffer and bears the consequences of the sin of the world. The cross is the sign of the church because it is where we look to find the ultimate expression of love and priceless grace. I'd like to share with you now two prayers and invite you to share with me in them. The first contains words from Isaiah 53 and Psalm 51, and the second is by an author, Christine Gerrard. Let's pray. God of Jesus, God whose love is poured out on the cross, we confess that we all, like sheep, have gone astray. We have all turned to our own way. We have sinned and thus contributed to Christ's suffering. Forgive us, we pray. Remove the sins that distance us from you and from those we love and care about. Create in us a clean heart, O Lord, and renew in us a right spirit. Loving God, now we know all is grace, all is gift. You give us all good things, life and love, daily bread and water that quenches our thirst friends and faith. Most of all, in your Son Jesus, you meet us with a love that will never let us go. You utter words of mercy and forgiveness that override the hurts and heal our brokenness. You offer new beginnings where we had expected only dead ends. We give you thanks and praise for the mystery of your suffering love that gives us life. We give you thanks and praise that you know our weaknesses and hear our prayers. We give you thanks and praise that all our dying and living is held in your good keeping. Now we know all is grace, all is gift. We give you thanks and praise. And we pray together the prayer that Christ taught us.
Our Father in heaven, hallowed be your name. Your kingdom come, your will be done on earth as in heaven. Give us today our daily bread, and forgive us our sins as we forgive those who sin against us. Save us from the time of trial and deliver us from evil. For the kingdom, the power, and the glory are yours, now and forever. Amen.
Sorry.